Well, good evening, everybody. Yeah, my name is Scott McKee. It's been my privilege to serve as the senior pastor here at Ward Church for 13 years. And we're glad to have you tonight. I want to tell you about a new spiritual practice I started in the last few years that some of you are going to find a little odd. And that is, a few years ago, I started praying for my grandchildren. And some of you are thinking, well, that's not odd. A lot of people pray for their grandchildren. That's not weird at all. No, a lot of people do pray for their grandchildren, but I don't have any. And my kids are still in my house, and I have a high school age daughter. We're not ready for grandchildren. And so I think that makes praying for grandchildren a bit unusual. Anybody else pray for non-existent people? Does that ever make your prayer list when you're making your list of things to pray for? Pray for people in Ukraine and people in my church and people who do not exist but might perhaps someday in the future, someday. Yeah, does that ever make your list? Praying for non-existent future people may be unusual, but I want to tell you where I got the idea and why you might want to adopt the practice, not just of praying for grandchildren, but praying for future generations and thinking generationally. The idea, the promise, really, is found in multiple places in the Bible, but it's actually quite easy to miss. The first time it appears, it is nestled right in the Ten Commandments, and you'll remember that some of the commandments have some commentary attached to them that's left off when the Ten Commandments are summarized on a bookmark or a plaque, and I want to read it for you tonight, and this is the main scripture passage of the night. And while I'm tempted to invite you to remain seated because you've been standing a long time, it's our practice here and in many of your churches to stand for the reading of God's Word. So if you don't mind, one more time, would you please stand to your feet? And then at the end of the scripture reading, I will say, this is the word of the Lord. And if you would please say, thanks be to God, and say it like we've just received an amazing gift because we have. Right? Tonight's scripture reading, the Old Testament book of Exodus, beginning with verse 20. Chapter 20, beginning with verse 1, excuse me. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Thank you. Well, you've just read the first two of the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods before me, and you shall not have any graven images or idols. An idol, as you know, was something made to represent God. And in ancient days, it was a statue to which they bowed down and worshiped. But often an idol is an image of God not fashioned in stone, but fashioned in our minds. The Bible says that God made humanity in God's own image, and we have returned the favor and made God in our image. And the image of God that we fashion in our minds may or may not look anything like the real God. And when we do that, we are worshiping a graven image, a false image. But more broadly, an idol can be anything that takes the place of God, anything that consumes our devotion or forms our identity. And God says in the second commandment, don't do that. Don't make for yourself any idols. Find your security and your identity in me alone. But did you notice what was added to that commandment? What happens if something like idolatry is allowed to take root? This is what we heard read earlier, this part of the passage. It said, you shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. And then here's the line, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. So here's the first instance of the behavior of parents affecting future generations. There is a ripple effect for good or for bad from our behavior. And here the consequence of sin goes 3 and 4 generations. And as pastors and counselors, we see this all the time. right? Addictions, abuse, shame tend to run 3 and 4 generations deep. And if you haven't taught on this in a while, this could be a good time to return to this. We recently did a series here trying to help people break the generational chains of dysfunction and to start a new kind of family legacy. We all have family wounds, and they affect generations. But tonight, I'd like to focus on the more positive part of tonight's passage. Yes, the sin of the parents has consequences to the third and fourth generation, but God says, I am showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. We tend to focus on the 3 and 4 generations, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. So the consequence of sin goes 3 and 4 generations, but the blessing of obedience goes 1,000 generations. The curse goes 3 and 4 generations, but the blessing goes, yeah, that's better, right? And in Bible times, a generation was thought to be about 40 years. Today I hear a generation referred to as about 25 years, but in either case, 1,000 generations is a very, 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 very long time, and God has promised to show love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. Now, is this poetic hyperbole? Or does my obedience of God and my love of God actually affect future generations? And I found this kind of inspiring to think generationally. It's motivated me really to live and pray differently. I have long prayed for my own children, but recently I decided to bump it out and pray for the kids that my kids might have someday. And then I bumped it out another level and I prayed for the kids of the kids of the kids that my kids might have someday. And then I prayed for the kids of the kids of the kids of the kids. You get the idea. Yeah, bless my family for 1,000 generations. If this world is still being renewed 1,000 generations from now, may my family continue to be blessed and to be a blessing to others in Jesus' name. I started to think maybe some of the blessings that I enjoy are mine because of the faithfulness of an ancestor of mine back in Scotland 100 years ago. Maybe my life has gone as well as it has because some hardy, hairy Highlander prayed for me. Maybe she did. That's a Highlander joke. Those are my people. Praying for future generations can be a lot of fun, right? Are your own kids frustrating you right now? Skip right over them and go to the next generation. You have little kids in your home, just start praying for your grandkids and your great-grandkids and your great-great-great-grandkids right now. You get the idea. And this works, by the way, even if you have no biological children or biological grandchildren. You have spiritual children. You have people whose lives are affected by your life and by your prayers. I've started to pray for the future pastors of this church. I've started to pray for the pastors of our region. I don't know what pastors are going to face 100 years from now. 500 years from now, in my imagination, it's going to be pretty tough, but I don't know. God has promised to show love to them for 1,000 generations. They're going to be okay, but I pray for them anyway. Now, I realize that praying for future non-existent people is unusual, and maybe you will think that I'm on thin theological ground. And I admit that I haven't heard anyone teach on this in exactly this way, which concerns me. However, our God exists outside of time and limits, and so praying to 1,000 generations seems like fair game to me. And if I am off theologically, I have no doubt that some of you brothers and sisters will pull me aside tonight and correct me. And really, if I am in deep theological error, I want you to correct me, really. But if it's a minor theological error, or if it's a medium theological error with minor significance, let me have this. Because it has energized my prayers. It has stimulated my imagination. It's made me more of a futurist. It's helped me take the attention off of myself. God has promised to show love for 1,000 generations. Stop sweating. Stop worrying. Now, we have a role to play. That's true. This passage does suggest that how I love God and how I keep God's commandments affects future generations. That is what it said. Let's look at it again. Showing love to 1,000 generations of who? Those who love me and keep my commandments. That is what it says. But the real focus of this passage is not on my behavior, but on God's covenant faithfulness. And this is where it gets really exciting. So let's stop looking forward for now and spend a few minutes looking backwards in time. Sometimes it really helps to look back. Looking back 3 or 5 years can really help you gain perspective, can it not? But imagine thinking back 100 years. Think back 500 years and you will really gain perspective. We tend to think in terms of decades. I came of age in the 1980s. I remember and love the 80s. Some of you came of age in the 1970s, and you remember and love the 70s. Some of you came of age in the 1960s. You remember nothing about the 60s, but you love them anyway. We think in decades, but history is judged in millennia. So when you're facing a really tough time, and it feels like you're all alone, and nobody's ever faced what you're facing, it can be helpful to bump out 100 years, 500 years, 1,000 years. We are not the first people to face a pandemic. We are not the first Christians to live out our faith in a secular society. We are not the first people to face oppression and persecution. You are not the first pastor to be criticized for preaching. Charles Spurgeon, the prince of preachers, was accused of having too much levity in the pulpit. He was accused of being too funny. Do you know how many pastors in history have been accused of being too boring? All of them. You're not the first preacher to be criticized. Of the Apostle Paul, people said he is unimpressive and his speaking amounts to nothing. His critics said the Apostle Paul's speaking lacked weightiness. The Apostle Paul. Can you imagine someone saying, Apostle Paul, we're going to go to the house church down the street because we're just not being fed. And the Apostle Paul saying, yeah, well, get out of your high chair and feed yourself then. Sorry, that was my fantasy, not Paul's. Paul, we like it better when Apollos preaches. When's Apollos up next? You are not the first pastor to be criticized. Anybody ever have somebody post something negative about them on social media? Yeah, that really stings, right? They didn't have social media in the 16th century, but someone did put into writing a review that accused a certain pastor of being ambitious, presumptuous, arrogant, cruel, evil, vindictive, greedy, and ignorant. That's not how we think of John Calvin. But that's what somebody wrote about him. You are not the first pastor to be called liberal and conservative in the same day. You are not the first pastor to struggle with depression. In 1527, Martin Luther wrote these words, "For more than a week, I was close to the gates of death and hell. I trembled in all my members. Christ was wholly lost to me." This is Martin Luther. "The contents of my depression are always the same, the loss of faith that God is good and that he is good to me." Charles Spurgeon, the same pastor who was accused of being too humorous, in 1866 told his congregation about his depression. He said in a sermon, "I am the subject of depressions of spirits so fearful that I hope none of you ever get to such extremes of wretchedness." Hudson Taylor, one of the most famous missionaries of all time, brought the gospel to China, battled depression his entire life, and in an unpublished note discovered after his death, he said that he was tempted to take his own life. God used every one of those people in great ways. They walked with God, they loved God, they served God, and they suffered terribly with depression. Bumping it out a level to get a long historical view gives comfort and perspective. It pulls me up of my own personal pity party, and I realize that I am not alone and that God has been faithful through the generations. Our theme this week is recharge, And one of the ways we recharge is to review. We look back and gain hope from history. And when you take the long view, not only do you get comfort and perspective, but we stop using words like unprecedented. When we say something's unprecedented, we mean it's unprecedented in this decade or unprecedented in my lifetime. But when you take a long historical view, you will discover that very few situations are truly unprecedented. By playing the long game, we gain perspective. In the Bible, the long game is God's covenant with his people, which he initiated as a family deal. Covenant promises, you know, are always extended to God's people and to their descendants and to their children. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are our spiritual ancestors. We are in their spiritual lineage. Now, they weren't perfect. In fact, you know, their family had generations of deep dysfunction, right? This family's got lots of issues, favoritism, deception, jealousy, withholding of blessing. This family needs a lot of help. They need Dr. Phil, Dr. Laura, Dr. Ruth, Dr. Pepper. They need somebody. And yet God makes and keeps his promises to this family. Even when this family doesn't keep their end of the agreement, God keeps his. And this ought to be a real encouragement for our families and for our congregations. God keeps God's promises. This is what the psalmist says in Psalm 105. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever. The promises he made for 1,000 generations. The covenant he made with Abraham. The oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. God started with Israel as God's chosen people, but then in Christ expanded it, right, to include all of us who've been adopted into this family, all of us who've been engrafted into this family, and now these historic family promises extend to us. The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob is our God too. But now the family, the whole family, old and new, are held together in Jesus Christ. That is our history. There was a time when Moses gathered the people in the wilderness to remind them about their own history. They were soon to enter the promised land, and the mantle of leadership was going to be passed from Moses to Joshua. And Moses wanted to prepare the people for this transition. And so he gives a speech that is essentially his farewell speech. And this is what Moses said to the gathered people in the wilderness that day. He said, "The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples." That's not why he did it. "For you were the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors, that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know, therefore, that the Lord your God is good. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments." The Lord did not set his affection on you or choose you or rescue you because you were bigger or stronger or smarter than others. You weren't. So why did God do it? Because God loves you, and because God keeps God's promises. That's what God said to the people in the wilderness that day. That's what God says to us right now. We are part of those 1,000 generations to whom God promised to show his love. We are in their downline. And the Hebrew word here used for love is that great Hebrew word hesed, which can be translated kindness or loving kindness, or mercy, goodness, faithfulness, love. And one commentator has observed, when applied to Yahweh, hesed is fundamentally the expression of his loyalty and devotion to the solemn promises attached to the covenant. We are part of his covenant people, and that brings real confidence and hope. Let the promises of God recharge us tonight. In the height of the pandemic, Carrie Job released a worship song called The Blessing. The YouTube version has a gajillion views. A lot of churches sang it, ours included. And the lyrics of the song are mostly the priestly blessing from Numbers chapter 6 during the time of Moses. You know, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. That's Numbers chapter 6. But then in this song, there's this song, this phrase that repeats, God is for you. 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 Some of you don't like songs that repeat. I get it. But in the pandemic, we needed to hear those words. And after about the 11th time, those words began to sink in and were like salve to my soul. And some of you need to hear those words now. God is for you. God is for you. He is not against you. God is for you. God is for you. And when God said that he will show love to 1,000 generations, he was saying definitively, I am for you. So from our passage today, three takeaways. Love God to the best of your ability. But you're not going to love him perfectly. Follow God's commands to the best of your ability. When you love God, we're going to want to follow his commands, but you won't perfectly obey God's commands. And thirdly, trust in God's steadfast, unwavering promise of loving kindness. God perfectly keeps his promises. He is for you. So at ease, parents who are worried about your kids, at ease, pastors who are worried about your congregations, you won't get everything right. You don't need to get everything right. God's covenant of love extends to 1,000 generations. He loves your kids. He loves your grandkids. He loves your congregation even more than you do. In hindsight, and with full disclosure, one of the reasons I started praying for my grandchildren several years ago is because a few years ago I was diagnosed with advanced stage colon cancer, and I had a rare form of colon cancer for which the survival rate is about 50%. So for a time I was convinced that I would never meet my grandchildren, and that thought bothered me more than just about anything else. I am not afraid to die. Fear was not part of my story at any point. I often recited the old Heidelberg Catechism, my only comfort in life and death is that I belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. I know that I belong to Jesus. I know that whatever happens to me, I'm going to be okay. But the thought of not being there for my kids and my grandkids grieved me. And the thought that my wife, Angie, might have to become a grandparent by herself seemed unfair to her. So when I thought I would never see my grandchildren or be able to pray with my grandchildren, I started to pray for my grandchildren. I figured I better front load those prayers right now while I can. Get those babies in. And today my cancer is in full remission, and after chemotherapy and a couple surgeries and lots of prayer, I am, thank you. I'm starting to dream about the future in ways that I haven't been able to do the last few years. I'm logging corny jokes for future grandchildren and keeping those at the ready. But I'm going to continue praying for 1,000 generations. That's a new discipline of mine that I do not intend to cease. Now, anyone with cancer in remission will tell you that they live with the knowledge that cancer can come out of remission. And I try not to dwell on that real possibility, but honestly, it is somewhere in my mind every day. But living with the lingering question of cancer is not a curse. It keeps me grateful. It keeps me in the moment. I plan for the future, but I'm under no guise that I am in control. Angie and I have already talked about our grandparent names. Anybody ever do this, like talk about your grandparent names before you have grandchildren? And I always thought our kids would call us Nanny and Papa, because that's what my kids called my parents. But Angie just recently said to me, I think I want to be called Gigi. I think I want the grandkids, she said, to call me Gigi. I said, well, that's okay, but I don't want to have to be pee-pee. We're starting to talk about the future, and that's a really good thing. We're dreaming about the future of our family. We weren't perfect parents, and we're sure not going to be perfect grandparents, but we have known God's loving kindness at every turn, and we rest in His promise to extend His love to 1,000 generations. I'm not a perfect pastor. I didn't follow a perfect pastor. I won't be succeeded by a perfect pastor. But God works in and through imperfect people. That's one of the major threads of the Bible. God has promised to show His love to 1,000 generations, and God always keeps God's promises. Would you stand to your feet and pray with me? God, every person here has experienced both blessings and curses that have been passed through generations. Teach us as parents and pastors to break generational curses and to become people of generational blessing. Help us to love You and to obey Your commandments. Thank You for Your great love for us and for Your promise to show love to 1,000 generations. Thank You for calling us Your children and for reminding us in hundreds of ways, both great and small, that You are indeed for us. We pray Your blessing on every family and on every church family represented here. May our lives bring You glory in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.